I loved every minute of it, but this year was the sweetest.
Definitions are a reference for standards, and so are the Boston Celtics. Their success over the years has created a sense of pride and tradition, justified by the number of championships they've achieved. But the story of success with the latest championship goes beyond the perfection of passing, rebounding, and shooting. Important as those elements may be, the way in which this Celtic team was assembled makes it as unique as the talent itself. Piecing the squad together began in 1978 when Boston drafted Larry Bird in his junior year at Indiana State. The wizardry of assembly continued 2 years later when the Celtics traded the number 1 and 13th pick in the draft for Robert Parish and the 3rd pick overall. The selection turned out to be Kevin McHale, and the deal speaks for itself. Next, the Celtics went to bat for the services of Danny Ainge. Their fight with baseball's Toronto Blue Jays brought Danny home to Boston. A swap with Phoenix had Rick Roby go to the Suns for Dennis Johnson. An already strong bench of Wedman and others got stronger with Jerry Seasting. And last summer, before the call went out to complete the picture, Bill Walton picked up the phone and called the Celtics. Although there was good fortune which allowed Walton to become a free agent, his eventual signing, along with the others, has been masterfully arranged. Revealing the reason why the Celtics are champions finds Red Auerbach, Casey Jones, and general manager Jan Vogt, who with the help of their staffs have assembled one of the greatest teams of all time in a year that will be remembered as the season of the shooting stars. Roll call, opening night. The start of a new season initiates a feeling of optimism. And in the game of basketball, that feeling intensifies, since a team can be improved with the addition of just a player or two. Coming off a season just 2 wins short of its 16th NBA crown, Boston was determined to amend what could have been the year before. But as Casey Jones points out, the difference in seasons was more than determination.
The difference between this team and last year, I would say, would be the health of the team and improvement in the bench.
Going into the opening game, our team had a tremendous amount of anticipation of what our team was all about. We had Bill Walton, we had Jerry Seasting. We really kind of, it was the encountering a new season, a new challenge. We all came out knowing that we wanted a world championship.
But the Celtics also knew they were starting the season minus the help they would eventually need to win. Larry Bird entered the opener against New Jersey ailing in his back and elbow, although his hustle and stats of 21 points and 10 assists didn't show it. But the Nets took advantage of Bird's situation and 28 Celtic turnovers, with the results giving New Jersey a 113-109 win in overtime. It wasn't the start Celtics fans expected, but patience would console frustration as the following night, Boston evened its record on the road against the Cleveland Cavaliers. The 105-100 victory set a pace, which would soon have the rest of the league scratching their heads in defense. There's no place like home, and in the NBA, there's no arena like the Boston Garden. Draped in tradition and success, the Garden has become a house of champions. But underneath all the history are the teams that make legends a reality. The 1985-86 Celtics could be one of the best teams ever assembled. A contribution to that argument is Bill Walton, whose first night in the Garden as a Celtic somehow seemed destined.
Loved it. I've never seen a man come into a training camp with as much desire to produce as he has shown for the Boston Celtics, and already the people are getting the idea that a lot rests on this guy's shoulders.
But in the home opener against the Bucks, the bulk of work would be accomplished by the passing game. When it wasn't in effect, the Celtics proved they weren't just a passing fancy, as they treated Milwaukee to a sample of their perimeter game or the efforts of the team's front court. On defense, the Celtics were equally effective, as they stopped Milwaukee from passing the buck and cashed in with a 117-106 victory. But Bird was forced to sit out in the third quarter, increasing concerns about his readiness. With its first of many winning streaks assembled, Boston turned its attention to the Atlanta Hawks and Dominique Wilkins. Interest in the game focused on the concern over the lack of speed in the Celtic front court. So Boston prepared to answer the critics with heads-up basketball. While Wilkins performed his show of 32 shots and 40 points, Boston waited patiently for their opportunities as a team, proving a set of hearts beats an ace no matter what game you're playing. Thank you. The 109-105 win over Atlanta propelled Boston into first place in the Atlantic Conference. It would be a position they would never relinquish. Winning ways continued on the road against Washington, adding to what would eventually become an 8-game winning streak. During the stretch, Bird emerged to answer those who said he wasn't 100%. Although he was hurting at times, games like the 47-point performance against the Pistons hid the fact. The whole team demonstrated passing perfection and tenacious defense, with the support and enthusiasm of all being simply marvelous. Celtic play through the month of November was not only being applauded, but it was being compared with some of the best ever to occur in the NBA. Finishing the month with a 15-2 record overall, Boston was in firm control of the Atlantic Conference. Added to the praise of Celtic play was the squad's spirit and unselfishness, which was gaining as much attention as any other attribute. Certainly, great teams must have great players, but they also must have athletes that know the need to sacrifice and pass the ball. This is an ability the Celtics could write a textbook about.
I think the Celtics' passing game is so outstanding because it stems from an unselfish attitude between our players. And I think that's both on the court and off the court.
Camaraderie was becoming more than a factor for winning. It was developing into an existence of personal importance. Winning remained a priority, but in an effort to take advantage of success, enduring the journey to a championship was recognized as part of the fun. As a result, the mood during practice at Hellenic College sometimes resembled that of schoolyard play. Enjoying success has always been a Celtic treasure, for if winning didn't matter, the Celtics wouldn't want to play. The Celtics picked up where they left off the previous month, but in the end, the month of December would be nothing to remember. Following wins over Milwaukee and New Jersey on the road, Boston returned home to face the Portland Trail Blazers and their only home loss of the season. The 121-103 defeat was also the only game the Celtics would lose by more than 10 points during the regular season. But despite the dismal record of 8-5 during the month, the Celtics never lost more than two straight, an accomplishment they would carry throughout the season. Such a statistic is credited to Boston's aggressive style and desire to win.
The aggressive style that we play really comes from the players. They know that the game in the NBA is played with aggression, and in order to succeed, you have to be aggressive.
There aren't that many players playing in the NBA that they shouldn't all be talented. The distinctive features go beyond that. They go to intelligence, they go to the willingness to, in some cases, subordinate their talent to the talent of others on the team, and their desire to win.
When I see Larry and Danny dive after loose ball or go falling over a table or chair, then I'm excited about that.
Well, you know, when you love somebody, like a parent loves a child, it's tough to be objective. But Danny has always been a very aggressive person. Whatever he did, he always wanted to win. But he's also a very sensitive, loving, and kind child.
Say cheese.
Cheese. Adding to the portrait of pride within the Celtics tradition are the scheduled family events. Taking time out for the holidays, the Celtic family gathered together at the Blades and Boards Club at the Boston Garden. Was the season during the season when the players had a chance to show off their own personal teammates and reveal the true advantages to playing at home. The event also provided time for players to relax among teammates without anticipation or the exhaustion of a game on their minds. But like most events that time of year, it was the children who had the most fun. The night was also successful in its efforts to release the tension of the season. Some of the entertainment for the night was scheduled, while most was spontaneous.
Let's all stand around and be nice, okay? Come on. All right, okay, Adam.
The night concluded with gifts for the children and anticipation of a Christmas Day game with the Knicks for the players, with the latter group receiving the biggest surprise. Come Christmas Day, there was more than presents that came unwrapped. The Celtics got their stocking stuffed with the game out of character, but it would later serve as an inspiration for preventing something similar ever to occur again. With Boston leading by 25 midway through the third quarter, New York mounted a comeback led by the charge of Patrick Ewing, who finished the game with a career-high 32 points. The Knicks nibbled away at Boston's lead by closing within 10 points at the end of the third quarter. New York continued their efforts and tied the game before the end of regulation. In the first overtime, the team stayed deadlocked as they traded baskets in a similar fashion. But in the second overtime, New York took control of the game and scored a court-record 16 points in an overtime period, leaving Boston dazed. But the 16 points produced by the Knicks may have served as an omen for Boston in its quest for a 16th championship.
The loss to New York on Christmas Day was something that was embarrassing to the players, but yet we have the makeup of personalities on the team that nothing really gets them down for long, and they were able to bounce back and carry on. And you have to do that over an 82-game schedule. You can't have those lows that are going to carry on for days, and you want to just keep consistent play and carry on.
The effects of the Christmas Day game were not visibly detected. To change their mood and approach would certainly mean a greater defeat for the Celtics than the one in Madison Square Garden. Boston finished 1985 with wins over the Clippers and former teammate Cedric Maxwell, as well as a dramatic win over the Utah Jazz, with both games setting the pace for the post-Christmas surge that would drive the Celtics into the playoffs and the record books. But when practice sessions were completed, some of the most competitive competition began.
Double dribble.
He did too.
I didn't. That's all I'm telling you.
Good try.
I didn't do it.
It's easy to play when you go like this.
No, it was.
I didn't do it.
Because when I went to get it with this hand, this hand came
up. Oh, get out of here. You double dribbled the ball.
No, I didn't.
Quick try. I'd like to do something. I'm good. I stole your brainwave last time.
You cheated.
I controlled you. Look at this.
Nope.
Okay.
Here's a
bomb. No! You got to be before.
But I win.
Get out of here.
You had both hands and I'm like, well, I'll
and I called foul and you said no and continue to play. You say you can stop me anytime you want anyway, so give me the ball. Give me the ball and prove it.
Offensive foul.
Why didn't you shoot that shot last night?
Oh.
Thank you very much, Bob.
I stole his brainwave.
There's a stand a treat down Causeway Street. It's a guarantee before you take a seat that the Celtic team will perform a feat of a passing game that can't be beat. First, she's the thief who throws the bird, who gets the ball and the word to a man named Ainge who's got the range and makes the most of what he's got by making good on a three-point shot. They'll start to play with DJ, who makes the thing to see sting, with Kevin McHale on the trail as a last loop going to the hoop. There's more to see in this passing scene, a dozen players with ability, like Benson, Thurkill, Wedman, Kite, and Big Bill. But before you go and hit the aisles, stick around for Rick Carlisle. It's the same attack in Pontiac, a standard affair in Madison Square, in the Omni, Mecca, Meadowlands, or Summit. But the real mystique is what's unique. It's a standard treat down Causeway Street. Down Causeway Street.
The Celtics had beat the wrap of Christmas Day and were riding a winning streak in January. But getting blown out in the first half in Atlanta, the streak seemed in jeopardy. Boston had visions of the infamous Christmas Day game dancing through their heads and decided to mount a comeback of their own, which was inspired by more than just Christmas memories.
And Atlanta had been waiting, I guess, about a month to just get us. They'd been on a roll, and little did we know coming in that they had this kind of emotion built up already. They started the first quarter off and just ran us off the court. At halftime, we're down 23. It was not enough, but they had a 23-point lead at the time. But they also had to verbalize. At halftime, the Robert Parish said, they're talking at us, they're slamming us, and then they're talking more. And each time he mentioned a word, it seems like he got a little more angry. And we went back out the second half, and everyone responded.
In the second half, the Celtics shot 64% from the floor, and led by Bird's 41 points, Boston nailed down the comeback 125-122 in overtime, sending a message to everyone. The next game was special, not because of any great comeback, but because the Los Angeles Lakers had come back to the Garden for the first time since the championship series last June. And the Celtics were set to prove that they were a different team. A 110-95 win over the Lakers, coupled with a comeback in Atlanta, gave Boston the confidence needed to run a record of 12-1 during the month of January and take an inspirational look towards the playoffs. Performances for good causes, off the court, are also part of the Celtics' style. Managing time for such events is a problem, but taking time to strut their stuff for charities like the Massachusetts Special Olympics is that little extra that makes the Celtics special. Riding a 13-game winning streak, the Celtics were hit with a traveling call that would take them to the West Coast to play 7 games in 10 days, all in different cities. The trip was a crucial point in the season for several reasons, including a final matchup with the Lakers. The Celtics were hoping to manage a better-than-break-even record on the swing and then return home to the Garden, where they hadn't lost since early December. But planning strategy for on the court seems to be the easy part of being on the road. When the cheering stops, it's time for another stop and anticipation of the next game. Although long road trips are expected in the life of a professional athlete, they are a demanding drawback to such a career. Every night, every player must be prepared to play at peak performance. And over a series of stops, getting ready for every game is a challenge. The Celtics completed a sweep of the Lakers on the swing and weathered the storm by beating Portland in OT to manage a 4-3 record on the trip. There was some time for relaxation in the climates that allowed for it. But although the players were able to enjoy some good times, it's always rewarding to get back to the people at home. Before coming home, the Celtics made one more stop in Hartford, where they'd finished the season 3-0. Once back in the Garden, it was the usual results as Boston continued its winning streak at home against the Spurs. The key to the Celtics' success was its bench and health, which was highlighted when Wedman replaced McHale during the winter stretch. Injuries were few during the season, but McHale missed 13 of 14 games during that period. But he was allowed ample time to recover from the injury, an opportunity which is rare in pro sport since hard play is expected with injuries as the accepted consequence.
Unless you're showing the effects of the rigors of the game, you know, you really haven't been playing that hard. It, in a sense, it goes with the game, and it's from the practices, but the ruggedness of play and how effective they are.
Injuries are only a fraction of the game which coaches prepare for. The video era finds the Celtics studying their play before and during halftimes of games, with the efforts producing substantial results. But consistent winning is built on basics, with the hope that strategy develops into reality.
Immediately when they showed 1-4, we'll put Larry right up in here, okay? You guys were right up in here, let's push him right away. Let's push him right out here. Push him right into this thing. We'll come right up and see if we can't seal.
Yeah, but then he sets the pick. The center is down here. Right?
This with them one time.
Your guy is here. So when he runs away, when you go off, this is where you go, because you know, he doesn't see you.
Another road trip found the eyes of Texas on the Celtics, opening the swing in Dallas, where Larry Bird won his long-distance shootout a month earlier. This time, he would do it for real, throwing in an amazing 50 points against the Mavericks. The Texas-style shootouts would continue in Houston and San Antonio. Bird concluded those three games with a 38-point average, including an 11-for-11 shooting performance in the first half against the Spurs. The efforts brought him another Player of the Week award and contributed to a year that gave him his third straight MVP trophy. An accomplishment achieved by only two others.
You now join Bill Russell and Wilt Chamberlain as the only players in the 40-year history of the NBA to win the league's MVP award 3 years in a row. And our sincere congratulations to you.
Receiving three straight MVP trophies says a lot. And it's said a picture's worth a thousand words. But a thousand pictures still doesn't give the word on Bird. Was magic for the Celtics. Coming down the home stretch of the regular season, Boston ran up its longest winning streak of 14 games. The winning ways allowed KC to play his bench and show the Celtics' true depth. With the starters searching for other challenges, Bird and Ainge, who would battle for the league's free throw championship with Golden State's Chris Mullen, battled for a championship of their own. Once back to work, the Celtics completed the season with a record 29 consecutive wins at home, with the best still to come.
walking off a little gingerly here.
Put your shoe off. Good job, Sam.
Let's go, man. Championship.
All right, guys. Let's go, man.
Before preparation for the playoffs was initiated, the Celtic family gathered once again in an effort to enjoy the candid moments necessary to release tension of professional play. A way of life that demands so much returns moments that are equally rewarding. The simple times are sometimes the best. Celtics knew the playoffs would be no picnic, but Sweet 16 was so close, they could taste it. With a regular season record of 40-1 at home, the Celtics opened the playoffs in the Garden against the Chicago Bulls and were set to prove that there was life after 40. Chicago had squeezed into the playoff picture, but despite a record which bordered on respectability, Boston recognized Chicago as a legitimate challenge.
Scout report is this. Danny, don't holler switchblade. If you switch, you get cured instead of Michael.
Michael Jordan had returned to the team after missing 64 of the 82-game schedule. His presence gave Chicago an outside shot at the Celtics, one that Jordan would take several times before the series would be over. The first game had Jordan assemble an amazing 49 points, some of which still have fans shaking their heads in disbelief. But his performance was not nearly enough to counter the combined efforts of Parish, Johnson, and McHale, who led the way to a 123-104 Celtic victory. It was the same old story of Celtic teamwork outdueling a one-man band. But since Jordan gave Chicago their best shot, the Bulls were set to go to him again and again in Game 2. Those lucky enough to be holding tickets for the second game were about to witness a piece of history.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Jordan finished the game with 63 points, surpassing Elgin Baylor's 24-year-old playoff mark of 61. Although Baylor's record was set in regulation and Jordan's in two overtimes, the performance was second to none. Almost as amazing as Jordan was the fact that Chicago had only one turnover in the first two quarters and that Boston shot a miserable 38% before intermission. But what seemed even more astonishing was that despite all these bullish figures, the Celtics only trailed by 7 at the half. To start the third quarter, the Celtics attempted some defensive changes, but the Air Jordan show continued. But while the Bulls' attention was on Jordan's record-breaking performance, Danny Ainge, who hadn't scored a point until midway through the third quarter, was about to break their backs. Ainge scored 11 points in the final 2.5 minutes of the third period as he brought the Celtics to within one, 84-83. Boston continued to chase the Bulls as the two teams exchanged leads through regulation, a first and eventual second overtime. By this point, Garden fans had gotten their money's worth. Now they were about to get what they came for. With less than a minute to play and the score tied at 131, Jerry Seasting would steal Jordan's show by delivering on this jumper. Boston would add a hoop and take a 135-131 victory and a well-earned rest before tackling Jordan and the Bulls in Game 3. In preparation for the third game, the Celtics set up everything but an anti-ballistic defense system to stop Jordan. Holding the superstar to 19 points, the Celtics cruised to victory with a balanced attack. By midway through the fourth quarter, it was a safe bet that the Celtics would advance in the playoffs. Ainge's performance in Game 3 was crucial in shutting down Jordan while adding some offensive punch. His improving efforts would be needed as the victory in Chicago completed only the first step towards Sweet 16. With the Bulls swept out to pasture, the Celtics turned their attention to the Atlanta Hawks, a team many felt was the sleeping giant of the playoffs. And although the Celtics swept 7 of 7 from the Hawks during the regular season, none of the games were won by a wider margin than 7 points. The Hawks, coming off an exhausting double overtime win against the Detroit Pistons, had little time to prepare, and that was something the Celtics took immediate advantage of.
They're going to hustle for boards.
take it on the defense floor.
The scene for games 1 and 2 was an intense Boston Garden. The Celtics came out a bit tentative as the Hawks kept pace and kept it close up to the half in game 1. But the third and fourth quarters were a different story as the Celtics outscored the Hawks in the third quarter 34-17, with Dennis Johnson dishing out 14 assists and all 5 Celtics starters scoring in double figures. Final score 103-91, and game 2 was little different. Enter the Hawks for game 2. And enter Larry Bird as he commanded the Celtics, scoring 36 points and garnering 7 assists. The Hawks found themselves quickly in a hole, down 2 games, heading back to the Omni in Atlanta, hoping to even the series. The Celtic dominance continued, though, as they disposed of the Hawks 111-107. The Hawks played better ball toward the end of game 3, but it was too little, too late. In game 4, the Hawks and owner Ted Turner got in tune, playing the kind of ball Red Auerbach made famous. Unselfish play and a tremendous 37-point effort by Dominique Wilkins gave the Hawks a 106-94 win to stunt the Celtics' chance at a sweep. At this juncture, a new Hawks star was emerging on the scene. His name was Spud Webb, the 5'7" guard who had 12 assists in game 4 and truly did fly like a bumblebee. Back in Boston for game 5. And with the Celtics making the necessary adjustments to contain Bumblebee Webb, they could sense that victory was not far off. The first 2 quarters, both teams battled back and forth, trying to establish their respective tempos. Larry Bird and Dennis Johnson kept the Celtics alive in the first half, and the Green breezed to an 11-point lead. What was to follow in the third quarter had each and every fan in the Garden believing that this team might even be better than anyone expected. The Celtics totally outplayed the Hawks to the tune of a 36-6 scoring run, including 24 unanswered points, while holding the Hawks scoreless during the final 5 minutes of the quarter. When the Hawks woke up, they were down by a cool 41, with the formality of the fourth period remaining. The Celtics wrapped up those formalities and moved on in style to the next round of the playoffs.
We're tying them off.
Watching, waiting, preparing. Under the eagle eye of their faithful mentor, the Celtics focused their energies on avenging a 1983 playoff series sweep at the hands of the Milwaukee Bucks. No one needed to tell the Celtics that winning 5-5 during the regular season had little significance now. This was a whole new ball game, or so the Milwaukee Bucks had hoped. From the opening tap, the Celtics came out storming. The barrage was led by an active Dennis Johnson and Kevin McHale, and with a fast break moving at full speed, Larry Bird joined the assault. Bird and McHale combined for 19 points, and the Celts led after 1, 29-12. In the second quarter, the Celtic dominance continued, and when Bill Walton got it off to a flying start, Don Nelson wanted to talk things over early. Walton would manhandle the Bucks in the second quarter, scoring 9 and gathering 5 rebounds. His intensity set the pace, and the Celtics took a 60-38 lead into the locker room at the half. Casey Jones kept the pressure on during halftime. The Celtics came up for the third period and never looked back. With Robert Parish scoring 10, the Celtics were on their way to cushioning their lead to 25. What was to follow was no different, as the Celtics went on to a 128-96 win in the all-important Game 1. Milwaukee was thoroughly outplayed on the boards and outshot in the field, something the Bucks knew they had to change to climb back into it for Game 2. 2 nights later, same place, same time. There was no Celtic letdown in sight as they led wire to wire, despite the return of a hobbled Sidney Moncrief. Kevin McHale, Larry Bird, and Danny Ainge all got into the act as the Green shot 57% from the field, including this 75-foot pass from Dennis Johnson to Larry Bird that went in. Blazing out of the locker room after the half, the Celtics quickly upped their lead to 11 on 2 quick three-pointers by Danny Ainge and Larry Bird. The Bucks kept it somewhat interesting as they cut the Celtics' fourth quarter lead to 4 as Terry Cummings scored 8 in the final stanza. But the Celtics' teamwork proved too much for the Bucks, as all 5 Celtics starters finished with at least 20 points and finished off the Bucks in game 2, 122-111.
Wait.
On to game three at the Mecca, and the Bucks thought they would call out the band for this one. The network joined the action as they and the national TV audience got to see the Celtics for the first time in the Milwaukee series, and they wouldn't be let down. The Celtics knew that winning game three would almost assure putting the Bucks in a hole and out of the playoffs for good. Only this one wouldn't come as easy as the first two, as the Bucks led the entire first half as a newly energized Sidney Moncrief poured in 15 in the first quarter. The Celtics kept it close, though, with Kevin McHale doing his share and garnering 13 points in the first half. With the Bucks up 60-53 at the half, they came out of the locker room booming as they upped their third quarter lead to 13. Although Scott Wedman went down with broken ribs, the Celtics were not about to let the Bucks spoil their sweep attempt as they whittled the Buck lead away like cheap plywood. Kevin McHale, Robert Parish, and Larry Bird provided the fourth quarter fireworks as the Celtics stole this one away from the Bucks 111-107, preserving their chance to take the Bucks out in a straight sweep. The duties sometimes overlooked are those of a truly skilled trainer. Here, Celtic trainer Ray Melchiori performs one of those duties, as Celtic Rick Carlisle provides the ankle and does the call.
Let's see if Ray can get through this tape job without any 20-second timeouts or any full timeouts. Right now he's doing the stirrups, going from medial to lateral, as is appropriate. Yeah, he's looking good so far. No stops for coffee or donuts. Yeah, looking really good here. Seems like he may be a little nervous doing it in front of the camera.
Yeah.
So nervous that he forgot that he's supposed to use 2-inch tape on me instead of an inch and a half, Ray. How about that?
With ankles wrapped and ready to go, the Celtics knew that game four would be a dogfight, with the Bucks trying desperately to save face with a home court win. But before the night was over, the Celtics would again be heard from in a fashion that one would remember. The Celtics would play to a slim 4-point lead at the half, as Danny Ainge provided the spark for the Celtics, scoring 15 of his 25 points in the first half. But as the game developed, it was the golden hands of this man that would rule the Celtics' destiny, as Larry Bird literally stole away a Milwaukee lead in the fourth quarter, hitting 4 3-pointers in the final 4 minutes. With help from Robert Parish, Bird would outscore the Bucks in the final stanza 17-16, leaving no doubts in the minds at the Mecca that he is for real. The Celtic locker room told the same story.
Yeah! Yeah! Oh my God!
Oh my God!
Okay, no problem.
After sweeping the Bucks, the Celtics had every reason to feel invincible. But in the back of their minds lingered memories of last year's NBA Finals. To a man, the Celtics said they didn't care who they met this year. But after watching the Celtics lose their title to the Lakers a year ago, all of Boston wanted a rematch. But there would be no rematch. Instead, they would be Ralph Sampson and the Houston Rockets. And what a series it would be. Though the Celtics had good reason to be concerned about the Houston Rockets, you certainly couldn't tell from the antics of Danny Ainge in the pregame locker room.
No heart.
While the Celtics might have been all jokes before the game, it was all business once they hit the court. From the opening tip-off, it was clear that this was not Houston's night. A violation gave the ball back to the Celtics, and they took it and ran. Though Houston scored first, Larry Bird buried two straight jumpers from the corner, and Boston took an early 10-4 lead. But with Robert Reed hitting five straight from the outside, and Akeem Olajuwon grabbing every loose ball underneath, the Rockets came roaring back. With the game teetering out of control, the Celtics needed a Larry Bird special, and they got it. At halftime, Boston led by only 2 points. But in the third quarter, the Celtics' defense forced the Rockets into crucial turnovers. With Houston threatening to close the gap to one, Parish blocked Sampson's shot. And suddenly, the Celtics had a breakaway basket and a 5-point lead. Moments later, DJ stripped the ball from Olajuwon, took the return pass from Bird, and Boston was on its way to a 12-point victory and a 1-0 series lead.
And Houston wants a timeout.
If Boston had a right to feel confident after Game 1, you couldn't tell it in the post-game locker room. A year ago, the Celtics had dropped the crucial second game, and they knew that this was no time to let up. Their wives and children might rest easier for this one day, but when the Celtics took the floor for Game 2, it was all systems go. With Bird and Ainge hitting from the outside, the Celtics jumped out to an 8-2 lead. After a dismal performance in Game 1, Ralph Sampson came alive in Game 2. But this game belonged to Larry Bird. With Bird having his best game of the series, the Celtics pushed their 10-point halftime lead to 25 by the end of the third period. Olajuwon and Peterson struggled to keep the Rockets within striking distance. But when Bird made an unbelievable pass to Seasting to give the Celtics their biggest lead of the game, it was time to pack the bags and head for Houston for Game 3. It was a 4-hour plane ride from Boston's Logan Airport to Houston, Texas. And another 40 minutes from there to the summit. By game time, all of the Celtics knew that Houston was predicting victory. And in the opening moments, it was the Rockets who took control. Though Boston won the tap, McRae knocked the ball loose from Larry Bird. And before the Celtics could get up court, he had jammed it home for two. The Celtics returned the favor on a fly pattern from DJ to McHale. But this game belonged to Houston. With the Rockets winning the battle underneath and Robert Reed scoring 16 first half points, it was Houston by 3 at the half. In the third period, the Celtics returned to the kind of basketball that they knew best. But with both Sampson and Olajuwon out hustling the Celtics on the offensive boards, the Rockets came from behind to steal a game the Celtics never should have lost. When the Celtics filed into their locker room after the game, they could still hear the cheering Houston crowd in the background. To a man, the Celtics knew that they had given this game away. And if the eerie silence of the post-game locker room told a story, it was that these Celtics knew they had no one but themselves to blame. But even in defeat, the Celtics refused to panic. They had lost a game, but they knew that if they didn't want their title dreams to go up in smoke, it was time to come together as champions. And that's just what they did. Though the Rockets came at the Celtics with every move they had, the Celtics came right back. Reed's hot outside shooting kept the Rockets out in front. But even when the Celtics weren't hitting, you could tell that they were fired up. Boston may have had trouble with Ralph Sampson in the first half. But in the third period, it was the Rockets who struggled. And with Robert Parish having his best game of the series, the Celtics took a one-point lead going into the fourth quarter. Rodney McRae made an unbelievable baseline move to tie it at 95. But with time running down, Bird hit a three-pointer to put the Celtics up 104 to 101. And when DJ missed a driving layup, Bill Walton was there to give the Celtics their biggest win of the year. With a 3-1 series lead, the Celtics had every reason to celebrate. And so did the surprising crowd of loyal fans who greeted them at their hotel. But there was still another game to play in Houston. And while most of the players seemed relaxed and confident in the pregame locker room, you could tell by the expression on Red Auerbach's face that he was concerned, and he had every right to be. In the first period, the Celtics stayed even with the Rockets. But exchanging baskets was never Red Auerbach's idea of good basketball. And when the game suddenly became ugly in the second period, it was Boston who took it on the chin.
And then turns around and feasting his force to take him in a low post, and he's coming at everybody, Ralph Sampson.
Broken out, the benches of Esty. And they're still going at it, and there is blood. Grabs Sampson from behind.
When Ralph Sampson left the game, Houston led by only 1 point. But with him out of the lineup, the Rockets took off. When the Celtics returned to Boston, they didn't need to read the papers to know how badly they'd been beaten. But if the 15-point loss had made them tense and edgy, it also made them hungry. And all the more determined to win Game 6 in championship style. In the pregame locker room, the Celtics were quiet, but intense. All year long, they had worked toward a common goal. And now, suddenly, it was in danger of slipping away. But as the hours, then minutes, ticked away until the opening tap, you could sense that these Celtics were ready. And so were the over 15,000 loyal fans who had packed the Boston Garden. If you know anything about the Boston Celtics, you know that they stand for teamwork, pride, and determination. But of all the great Celtic teams, this one seemed to have a special feeling. A special intensity. And a special love for playing with each other. That makes the 16th championship perhaps the sweetest of all.
How sweet is that? That's right, go ahead, kick our tail, see what happens.
Yeah. $45,000 too. Pow! $45,000 Pow!